thing. Let me show you this. See if you can see it in the camera. I've got like red marks on my nose here. That's from my goggles hitting my nose, because now that I have a very well working platform that's 1S and so quiet, I can wake up really early in the morning and fly anywhere I want because it makes no noise. So this is the 1S baby tooth. I haven't really made many, if any, videos about this yet. It's still a little bit early to talk about this, but this one is special because it's the standard platform. It's just the one I grabbed this morning. And this is 4 600 milliamp batteries. So that's 2400 milliamp of battery, and it weighs 99 grams all of weight. Now this is not really intended to run 4 600 milliamp batteries in parallel, which you just run single wire down each of the positives and negatives and you get parallel wiring. Anyways, this is really not intended for this. It's intended to run a single battery, 450 to 600 milliamps. The 650 is fine too, of course. You can run bigger if you want, but yeah, that's what its intention is. My guess is about somewhere between 20 and 30 minutes. And that is going to put me at being late for work. But all right. So last time people liked this sort of ad hoc kind of video, so I'm gonna do another one of these things. All right, so there's fires up north, so the sun is kind of gnarly today. So this is 99 grams all up weight, 1S. It's really not intended for carrying this much weight, but as you can see, it actually still has shockingly good performance for 1S. Now in the bottom right corner here, you'll see my throttle. And you can see my cruising throttle and what's happening. So this is a 1S 3-inch platform. And the beauty of 1S is that it's just so darn simple. That's really the beauty of it. And it feels great in the air, having such huge props and having such low overall weight, because it just feels like, it feels like you're a leaf, like you're just a falling leaf. So this is the most optimal setup that I've come up with in 1S and 3-inch props. And this is a very large prop for how light the quad is. And it carries its weight surprisingly well. And it's just such a joy to fly because it really shrinks down the entire field. Like it turns a small backyard into a full-blown FPV playground, which is so nice. And it does it without making almost any noise. Like I'm flying this thing right in front of me, you can't hear it. Here, I'll fly it around myself. That's all the noise it makes. That's it. Let's go full throttle. It can't make more noise than that. So it's really quiet. It only weighs this one with a normal battery, it weighs 54 grams all up weight, so it's really light and it's really hard to cause damage with props that honestly spin so slowly with such low weight. I mean, even if you run straight into someone, into your skin, it's going to not really hurt that much because it's just so light, so small. And the props, while they are spinning pretty quick, they're not really that fast, so they're not gonna cut up too much skin. So I hope that my goggle battery lasts this entire flight, and I hope that my GoPro battery lasts this entire flight, and I hope that I have enough time to fly before work. But let's talk about the flight time of a normal battery. It's usually somewhere between 2.5 to 3.5 minutes. If you kind of cruise like I'm cruising right now, you can get like 6 to 7 to 8 minutes even on a single 1S 450 to 600 milliamp battery. I just saw that sign. Talk about this setup in a second as well. And so the flight time's pretty good. It's been optimized for its overall performance, for its overall weight, for its overall carrying capacity. And the reason why it's 3-inch now and not 2-inch is because once you move from 2.5-inch to 3-inch, the overall prop diameter, the disc that the prop produces when it's spinning, is so much higher that it's just better at carrying weight. So the issue is that I want to be able to carry a reasonable loadout. I want to carry a pretty nice camera, and I want to carry Crossfire, and I want to carry a Crossfire TBS VTX on there. So I need to have that prop size. And that is what the deluxe version of this build is. It is the Crossfire with the Mini Mortal T antenna and the Pro 32 Nano VTX built in there. I'm really doing an ad hoc description of everything because it is really hard to fly and talk at the same time. And now there's a plane flying overhead, so that's gonna be on audio as well. But let's talk about the build overall. There is a blog post that has all the parts, and it will be kept up to date, and it has the links to all the parts as well as some tuning options for you in there so that you can get going pretty quickly and pretty easily. I'm just gonna let this plane fly by. The flight controller here is something that we've been developing for about 4.5 months now, and we went through a couple of revisions, and the whole point of making this flight controller was to make it, number one, easier to use. And you'll see that by the massive solder pads, and it has separate solder pads for the camera and the camera and the VTX on there, so you don't have to kind of double up wires on there. So it makes it super easy to solder. No motor connectors, and talk about that in a second. But the point of this flight controller is to try to improve quality control and reliability on this thing. So I've tried every single 1S flight controller I can get my hands on out there, and I have yet to find one that has respectable quality control, which is just appalling. But that might be because they were never intended to be used for such a size craft and for such loads. So this thing is not like a super low load quad. It's not as low load as a Whoop, and I've been using Whoop boards. So we've developed this 1S board specifically to be able to do this with it. And so it is a little bit higher performance. While the ESCs are like 8 amp consistent and 12 amp burst ESCs, we are only calling it 6 amp, because the circuitry in the flight controller is so hard to get to support higher amperage, because it's just so darn small, that we're only gonna say it does like 6 amps consistent, and we'll call it 8 amps burst. But that's enough for this little guy. It doesn't really need more. Set motor timing to high and you'll have no issues on the motors. But the flight controller is really unique because it's just so easy to use, and it's so, so nice. You'll also notice that it has some solder pads on the bottom side of it, and those solder pads are, firstly, there is a inverted or uninverted solder pad jumper, which allows you to run inverted and uninverted receivers, Spectrum, FRSky, anything you put on there. The CRSF protocol will work as well. Inverted or uninverted means that you can run everything that we know of at the moment. And it also has a jumper for 3-volt versus 5-volt voltage for your receiver as well. And then the rest of it, you'll see it's got solder pads for everything. And the reason it's got solder pads for the motors is because early on, we recognized that the motor pads, solder pads for motor lines, actually improved efficiency and performance pretty, obviously. It was a very obvious improvement. And then we moved from the PH2 connector to the XT30 connector, and there was a massive jump in overall voltage stability performance, flight time performance, and performance. and that is what we're using now. Now there are a couple other connectors that are available. The the BT2 connector from Beta FPV is available, and that connector is nice and it is useful. It's just not useful for this kind of a size quad. So if your quad is really ultra light, you can get away with a BT2 connector, but overall we found that moving from BT2 to XT30, it is a notable improvement in all of those things. As it's still like already, it just jumps in performance still from BT2 to XT30. Now there is another connector that is coming out very soon. We are going to have in stock. It's the GMB27 connector, and this connector is supposed to be a connector that's in between the BT2 and my flight time is now blinking. I didn't even know it blinked past a certain number. And I've tested it somewhat, and it does perform pretty well, although I would wish it had thicker pins in there to carry better current load. I haven't fully tested it yet on this setup. We will have it in stock when it is available, but it's yet to be seen if it's going to be really fully useful for this kind of a quad. We might have to stick to XT30. The amp load on this quad, it's really hard to gauge from OSD or any kind of amp readout on your OSD, but I would say that at max throttle, it's pulling 20 amps. It actually is pulling, it's trying to at least pull 20 amps. I don't know if the battery can provide it, but it's trying to pull 20 amps. So what else can I talk about? The motors. So these are 1202.5 motors, and 1103 motors will work okay, but the 12 size motor just has so much more control. And it feels so much better on the throttle and so much better on the sticks that's just the motor that is recommended for this sort of a build. And we are still researching motors. There are a couple of motors in prototype stages that are being tested, although the 1202.5 is still kind of the best performing overall motor in terms of actual performance, flight time, and characteristics, and weight. The weight is really a massive factor. All right, so there's two primary builds for this kind of a quad. One of the builds is the standard build, which is honestly the build that I am flying right now, and it's the build that I recommend. The standard build is just super simple. It's lighter. It's just super simple, and it's just super simple. That's why it's so nice. So it's the all-in-one board, motors, the frame, obviously. You can run it in 1.5 millimeter or 2 millimeter frame. I'll talk about those in a second. And then you run a whoop cam, 25 milliwatt whoop cam, which is what I'm flying right now. It's just a 25 milliwatt whoop cam. That's why the video signal is kind of not wonky, but not as great as you might want it to be. And so the performance is fine. It's not like the best. I do have a Tiny D8 receiver in there. That's the Emax Tiny D8 receiver. And that is a great receiver. It's not going to give you maximum performance, but it weighs like 0.4 grams, and it's like the smallest receiver. It's way better than any built-in SPI receiver, which is why we didn't even bother building in a receiver, because it was just a total waste of time to try and build in a receiver. The standard build with those weight-saving measures is going to be the absolute best performance on the 450 milliamp ADC battery, which we will carry, but we can't get them because GMB is out of those for now. So the deluxe build is the other build that is very special. And the deluxe build has Crossfire built in with the Mini Mortal T antenna. It did not last as long as I expected it. The Mini Mortal T, I'm going to keep flying until it just falls out of the sky. We'll see how far it goes. It's actually flying totally fine right now, but the battery voltage is dropping really fast. Wow. A lot faster than I expected. Wow, I did not expect that at all. 16 minutes only. Oof. All right. So let's just continue talking about the deluxe. The deluxe version of the frame build, I can't believe only 16 minutes. That is very interesting. The deluxe version of the frame build has the Crossfire with the new it comes with the original version of the Mini Mortal T antenna, which isn't quite as good as the updated version that we have now, which is intended for the 916 megahertz, and it performs significantly better than the previous one, a lot better than I expected. It's been tuned by TBS, and I'm going to do another video about all this a little bit later. And look at that, I'm just barely in time for work.